हेलो एंड वेलकम टू मेडक्विक। माय नेम इज डॉक्टर विपुल रावलानी। आई हैव डन माय एमबीबीएस फ्रॉम जीएमसी नागपुर एंड आई हैव सिक्योर्ड ऑल इंडिया रैंक ऑफ 46 इन नीट पीजी 2021 एग्जाम। सो गाइस, टुडे आवर टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज थायरॉयड ग्लैंड एंड इट्स डिसऑर्डर्स। सो इन दिस वीडियो वी विल ट्राई टू कवर अप एवरीथिंग दैट इज फ्रॉम बेसिक थायरॉयड फिजियोलॉजी एंड देन वी विल लुक इनटू फार्माकोलॉजी, देन वी विल कवर हाइपो एंड हाइपोथायरॉयडिज्म एंड देन वी विल कवर अप थायरॉयड इमरजेंसीज एंड थायरॉयड एनलार्जमेंट्स। सो आई हैव डिवाइडेड दिस इनटू टू सेशंस। इन दिस सेशन वी विल फर्स्ट लुक इनटू थायरॉयड फिजियोलॉजी and some hypothyroidism disease. Okay, so let us start. So let us first begin with some thyroid basic physiology. So as we all know, pituitary is the organ which controls the release of almost all the hormones that are released from the endocrine glands, and so is the case with the thyroid gland. So as we can see from this diagram, first the hypothalamus signals the pituitary to release the TSH by releasing TRH, and then this TSH act on the receptor present in the thyroid gland, and subsequently thyroid gland releases T3 and T4 hormones. So this we all know, and then this T3 and T4 hormone will give the feedback regulation to the pituitary gland to stop releasing the TSH. Okay, so one thing which we can infer from this diagram is that the TSH is acting via the cyclic AMP pathway, that is by G protein coupled receptor pathway. Okay, and T3 and T4 acting by the nuclear receptors. So this thing we have to remember. Secondly, second thing which we can remember is that apart from T3 and T4 which inhibit the TSH synthesis from the pituitary by feedback inhibition, there are other three things which can also inhibit this pituitary TSH secretion, and this can be dopamine, somatostatin and corticosteroid. These three can also inhibit the secretion of TSH from the pituitary. Okay, and also we can remember that any pathology which occurs due to primary disease in the thyroid gland, it will be called as termed as primary. And if the etiology is due to pituitary cause, then it will be termed as secondary. Okay, so suppose a case of Graves' disease or Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So Graves will be called as primary hyperthyroidism because the primary pathology is in thyroid gland itself. And suppose there is a case of hyperthyroidism due to pituitary adenoma. In that case, it will be called as secondary hyperthyroidism. Okay, because the pathology is associated with pituitary. So this terminology we should remember. Okay, so now let us zoom in and look into what is happening in the thyroid gland, how the thyroid gland is synthesizing the hormone. Okay, so let us look into this image. So as we all know that the iodine is iodine is essential mineral required for the thyroid hormone synthesis, and normally iodine requirement in a normal Indian adult is 150 microgram per day, which increases to 250 microgram per day in pregnancy. Okay, and children require lesser, that is 90 to 120 microgram per day. Okay, so iodine which we ingest is circulating in the blood, and then the thyroid follicle take this iodine with the help of sodium iodide symporter, okay, present in the basolateral membrane of the thyroid follicular cells, and then this iodine will get through the thyroid cell and will reach the colloid via the pendrin transporter. Okay, then this iodide will be oxidized from I minus to I plus by thyroid peroxidase enzyme. Okay, and then this positively charged iodine will combine with negatively charged thyroglobulin in the thyroid lumen to form complexes like monoiodothyroxine, diiodothyroxine, and these two will get coupled by coupling reaction to form T3 and T4. Okay, so this is the whole process. So in this process, the oxidation of iodine, organification of iodine and coupling reaction, all these three steps are taken by a single enzyme called as thyroid peroxidase. It is also known as dual oxidase. Okay, so after this colloid formation, we can see this complex as thyroglobulin, MIT, DIT, T3 and T4. Okay, this is stored as colloid, and this colloid can serve us with T3 and T4 in the next upcoming 3 to 4 months without any iodine. Okay, so this is there. So when signal comes from the pituitary in the form of TSH, it will stimulate the thyroid follicular epithelium, and then this colloid will be endocytosed into the thyroid cell, and then subsequently it will be released into the blood circulation. So the hormone types are two types, that is T3 and T4. So mainly the T3 is the main active form. It is considered as main active form. Okay, so most of the functions are done by the T3, but it has a lesser half-life. So half-life of T3 is less than 1 day, and half-life of T4 is around 7 days. So thyroid gland mainly releases T4. And then in the peripheral tissues, the T4 is getting converted to the T3 by the help of deiodinesis. Okay, so mainly thyroid gland releases T4. 80% is T4 released. So after the release, most of the thyroid hormone is bound to the protein present in the blood. So these proteins can be thyroid binding globulin, thyroid binding prealbumin and albumin. So among these three, it is the thyroid binding globulin which has the maximum affinity for the thyroid hormones. But since the albumin has the maximum concentration of the protein part in the blood, so largest capacity to carry the thyroid hormones is with albumin, but the maximum affinity is with thyroid binding globulin. And third is thyroid binding prealbumin. Okay, so it is also called as transthyretin. So these are the three proteins which carry the thyroid hormones, but it is mainly the free thyroid hormone which perform the main function of the thyroid. Okay, so then we have seen deiodinases. So deiodinases are the enzymes which are present in the peripheral organ and convert T4 to the T3. Okay, so deiodinases again are of three types, type 1, 2 and 3. So type 1 and 2 deiodinases are present almost in the all organs, and their main role is to convert T4 to T3. But the deiodinase type 3 present in brain and some reproductive organs, so it converts T4 to reverse T3. So we have seen that the T3 has the main function, but the reverse T3 is opposite. It is inert, it has no function. So why there is presence of such an enzyme which converts T4 to such a useless reverse T3? So to understand this, we need to understand sick euthyroid syndrome. Okay, so to understand this sick euthyroid syndrome, first let us look into some thyroid function. So as you can see, thyroid has many functions which are related to the brain maturation, growth, and then it has beta adrenergic effects, like it increases heart rate, stroke volume, heart contraction. Okay, so it also increases basal metabolic rate, it causes glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis, means it increases the blood glucose level, and that it causes breakdown of lipids and stimulate surfactant synthesis in babies. Okay, so there are many functions in thyroid, but we can generalize from this that it has mainly catabolic functions, that is lipolysis and glycogenolysis. Also it increases the BMR. So suppose there is a patient of very sick patient or severely burned patient or chronic starvation patient. So in these patients, we cannot afford to increase the BMR. So thyroid hormone main function is to increase the BMR and to cause catabolism. But in these sick patient or chronically ill patient, we cannot afford to have catabolic processes. So to counter this, we have deiodinase type 3. So in these sick patients, this deiodinase type 3 get upregulated and it convert T4 to reverse T3, which is inert. So the thyroid defects which are normally present, they get negated. Okay, so that the patient can have some anabolism. Okay, so then the BMR will not increase. We need to save energy in very sick patient. Okay, so this is the main thing. So now let us look into some pharmacological aspects of this. Okay, so first we'll look into antithyroid agents. So antithyroid agents can be firstly thionamides. So thionamides mainly act by inhibiting the thyroid peroxidase enzyme required for the synthesis of the thyroid hormones. Okay, so these thionamides are namely propylthiouracil and methimazole. So methimazole is 10 times more active than the propylthiouracil. So in almost all the cases, we use methimazole. But the backdrop of these thionamides is that they are inhibiting the thyroid peroxidase enzyme, that is the thyroid synthesis. But as we all know that the colloid can supply with thyroid T3 and T4 for almost a month or 2 months. So they require 1 to 2 months to show their action, because already there is thyroid synthesized in the gland. Okay, so these are thionamides. So in almost all cases we will prefer methimazole, except in two cases, like pregnancy first trimester and also in thyroid storm cases, because we will prefer propylthiouracil, because propylthiouracil has additional effect, like the propylthiouracil also inhibit the peripheral deiodinases required for conversion of T4 to T3. So because of that, this action we preferred in thyroid storm propylthiouracil. It is the drug of choice there. And also in pregnancy first trimester, propylthiouracil is preferred because it is more protein bound and it crosses placenta less readily. So propylthiouracil is preferred over methimazole in pregnancy first trimester. So second antithyroid agent are anionic inhibitors. These anionic inhibitors can be thiocyanate, perchlorate, pertechnate. So these also inhibit sodium iodide symporter, and these are not used nowadays because of rare side effect that is aplastic anemia. Okay, so these are not used. Third are iodides. So we have seen that the iodine is required for the it is the basic element for the thyroid hormone synthesis. But so how come the iodides have antithyroid effect also? So it can be explained via the Wolff-Chaikoff effect. So according to this effect, excess of iodine, it kind of have feedback inhibition of thyroid hormone synthesis and release. Okay, so iodides main mechanism of action is that they stop release of the T3 and T4. So the improvement of thyroid toxic symptom with iodides are very rapid. That is, it occurs in less 2 to 7 days. They show improvement in comparison to thionamides like propylthiouracil or methimazole. They show effect after 4 to 8 weeks. Okay, so these are very rapid onset of action because they inhibit the release of the T3 and T4. Also, the potassium iodide also has an additional benefit that it reduces the vascularity of the thyroid gland. So it is preferred, it can be given in pre-op patient, in surgical patient, so that we can reduce the bleeding per se. Okay, but since iodides can also increase the transiently increase the thyroid hormone synthesis, so in thyrotoxic patient, initially they can also worsen the patient. That is why they are not readily used nowadays. So, and fourth category is radioactive iodine. Radioactive iodine used for treatment is iodine 131. So how this acts is that we will give the radioactive iodine 131 orally, then it will go through the blood circulation via the sodium iodide symporter. It will get entered into the thyroid follicular epithelium and then will emit the beta rays and destroy the thyroid gland. And it has a half-life of 8 days, around 8 days. Okay, so this is how it will damage the thyroid gland. But only the contraindication of this is we should not give in the pregnancy or in nursing mothers, because they can these are radiation agents, so these are less preferred in pregnant and nursing mothers. Okay, and also they can worsen ophthalmopathy in Graves disease patient. So in these patients, firstly we give corticosteroid and then we will give radioactive iodine therapy. Okay, so these are not contraindicated in ophthalmopathy patient, but these are kind of relatively contraindicated. Okay, not absolute contraindication. Fifth agent are adrenoreceptor blocking agent like beta blockers. So as we have seen that the thyroid hormone action is parallel to the beta agonist action, beta agonistic action. So that is why we can use propranolol as antithyroid agent, and it also inhibits the peripheral deiodinesis. Okay, so this is how it works. So second class is, so now let us look into thyrotoxicosis and hyperthyroidism. So mostly we use both of these terms simultaneously, but both of these terms are very different. So let us see how they are different. So thyrotoxicosis means elevated T3 and T4, and hyperthyroidism means hyperfunctioning of thyroid gland. So elevated T3 and T4, that is thyrotoxicosis, can occur without the overfunctioning of the thyroid gland, or it can occur with the overfunctioning of thyroid gland. Okay, so to understand this, let us assume patient is taking T3 or T4 exogenously, means doctor has prescribed it. So in that case, the thyrotoxicosis which will occur, it will mostly be due to exogenous intake of T3 and T4, not due to the hyperfunctioning of the thyroid gland per se. Okay, so when should we suspect thyrotoxicosis? So thyrotoxicosis patient can present with unexplained weight loss despite an increased appetite, or it can be or patient can also present with hyperactivity, irritability, insomnia, heat intolerance, palpitation. So in all these cases, we should first suspect hyperthyrotoxicosis, and then we should investigate by doing TSH. Okay, so the thyrotoxicosis can be divided into associated with hyperthyroidism and associated without hyperthyroidism. Okay, so thyrotoxicosis with hyperthyroidism, in these cases the thyroid gland is overfunctioning. Okay, like Graves disease, toxic adenoma, toxic multinodular goiter, iodine induced, and due to maternal Graves. In all these cases, thyroid gland is overfunctioning and producing more T3 and T4 in comparison to thyrotoxicosis not associated with hyperthyroidism. In these cases, like granulomatous thyroiditis, subacute thyroiditis, in these cases there is thyroid gland destruction due to the lymphocyte. And in factitious thyrotoxicosis, patient is exogenously taking T3 and T4. So due to glandular destruction in thyroiditis and due to exogenous intake of T3 and T4, the thyroid gland as such is not overfunctioning, but there is increased T3 and T4. So there is thyrotoxicosis, but there is no hyperthyroidism as such. Okay, so we can visualize this thing by doing the radioactive iodine uptake scan. Okay, so suppose a patient is having hyperthyroidism. In hyperthyroidism patient, the thyroid gland is overfunctioning. Okay, so so the sodium iodide supporter, which was the first step of iodine uptake, so that step will also be over increased. Okay, so in these cases, in after we do the radioactive iodine uptake scan, the there will be increase in uptake, okay, because of the increase in sodium iodide supporter if there is hyperthyroidism, okay, as such. But if there is no hyperthyroidism, as like in case of thyroiditis or factitious thyrotoxicosis, the gland is not overfunctioning, so the uptake will be less. Okay, so we can see this image. So radioactive iodine uptake requires the use of iodine 123, and it emits the gamma rays, and these gamma rays are captured by the nuclear scan machines. Okay, so after the scanning, we can visualize the thyroid gland, as the normal thyroid gland will diffusely take the iodine, okay, like this. And if there is, suppose there is toxic adenoma or there is a hot nodule, so it will present as single darker area. So here, suppose a patient is presenting with thyrotoxicosis, but the radioactive iodine uptake is less, so we should suspect that the hyperthyroidism is not there. So the cause can be thyroiditis, ectopic thyroid hormone synthesis, okay, as in struma ho raha hai. But if a thyrotoxicosis patient has an increased uptake in the thyroid gland, so we should see whether the increased uptake is homogeneous or it is nodular. If it is homogeneous increased uptake, then we should suspect the Graves' disease, okay. And if there is nodular increase in the uptake, so it can be, if there are multiple nodules, then it is termed as toxic multinodular goiter. And if there is single area of accumulation, then it is termed as the toxic adenoma. Okay, so this is the significance of radioactive iodine uptake. And other points regarding the radioactive iodine uptake, we will look at in the next part, in the nodular thyroid gland enlargements. Okay, so let us look into the Graves' disease. So as we all know, Graves' disease is the most common cause of endogenous hyperthyroidism. It is also the most common cause of thyrotoxicosis as such. Okay, so Graves' disease mostly occur in females and in 20 to 40 year age group. Okay, so Graves' disease occurs due to an autoimmune etiology in which there is TSH receptor stimulating immunoglobulin. It is also known as TSH stimulating immunoglobulin, that is TSI. So these immunoglobulin are present in 90% of the cases. Okay, not in 100%, in 90% of the cases. So in Graves' disease, we can, after investigating, we can see that T3 and T4 are increased, whereas TSH is reduced due to the negative feedback regulation. Okay, so TSH will be reduced and T3 and T4 will be increased. And Graves' disease occurs due to autoimmune pathology. The genes involved in autoimmune pathology are PTPN22 and CTLF4. So these genes are required for the regulatory T cells for immune regulation. Okay, so these genes are affected. So now that immune will not be regulated as such, and there will be immune antibodies to the thyroid gland. Okay, so PTPN22 and CTLA4, these are affected genes, and it also has an HLA association, that is, it is associated with HLA-DR3. Same is the case of Hashimoto thyroiditis. It is also associated with PTPN22, CTLA4 and HLA-DR3. Okay, so both of these have same genetic part. Okay, so Graves' disease is special as such because it present with triad of hyperthyroidism, ophthalmopathy and dermopathy. We will see into the other causes of the hyperthyroidism, but they mostly do not have ophthalmopathy and dermopathy. It is special to the Graves' disease. So ophthalmopathy occurs in the Graves' disease because due to increased infiltration by the lymphocyte and inflammation and edema of the extraocular muscles, and because of these there is ophthalmopathy, that is, orbit will kind of appear like protruded orbit. Okay, so it is there. So if we microscopically look into the Graves' disease thyroid follicle, so we will realize that there is diffuse hypertrophy and hyperplasia of the thyroid follicular epithelial cells. Also, there is scalloping of the thyroid follicular epithelial cells. So you can look into this diagram that there is scalloping, okay, and the follicles are reduced in size because there is hyperfunction of each and every follicle is hyperfunctioning. So follicle size as such is reduced, but their number is increased and there is scalloping which is specific in the Graves disease, management of the Graves disease. So management of Graves disease is a multimodal management. That is, we use medical management, radioactive iodine and surgery, okay, step by step. So firstly, we will start the patient with medical management. If there is any no remission after the medical management, so then we will look up for radioactive iodine. And if there is any contraindication to the radioactive iodine, then we will do the surgery. Okay, so medical management involves the use of antithyroid drugs. So we have studied about the antithyroid drugs in the previous section only. So we will start the patient with methimazole, mostly except in pregnancy first trimester, we will start with propylthioacetal. So we will start patient with antithyroid drugs. But as we all know that these antithyroid drugs require 4 to 6 months to show their action. So because of the rapidity of action, we along with these antithyroid drugs, we use propranolol mostly, okay, which is a beta blocker. So this propranolol is used in the early stages before the antithyroid drug take into the effect. So these are beta blockers are used along with antithyroid drugs. So if there is no adequate response after the medical management, then we will look up for radioiodine. Okay, so in radioactive iodine we use iodine 131, as we have all seen, and it emits beta plus gamma rays, and it has half life of 8 days. Okay, so it is indicated for toxic multinodular goiter and in Graves disease, in which we have seen relapse even after the medical management. So radioactive iodine is contraindicated in pregnancy and in children, that is in lactating mother. Okay, it is contraindicated in these patients, but and it should also be avoided in patient who is having ophthalmopathy, Graves ophthalmopathy, because it can exacerbate the ophthalmopathy, but it is not contraindicated, we should avoid it. So if patient is having ophthalmopathy, we can give radioactive iodine, but after giving corticosteroids. So with radioiodine treatment, there is a small risk of thyrotoxic crisis after the radioiodine. So to reduce these thyrotoxic crisis, we can give pre-treatment with antithyroid drugs for at least a month, and after completing 1 month, then before the treatment of radioiodine, we stop these antithyroid drugs 2 to 3 days before. Okay, so then we will give the radioiodide, that is iodine 131, and then after giving the radioiodine 131, we can restart the antithyroid drug 3 to 7 days. So the third line of management is surgery. Okay, so usually we do not require surgery for hyperthyroidism per se, because it can be managed adequately with medical and radioactive iodine. But if suppose the gland is very large, or if it is presenting with some obstructive clinical features, or if we are suspecting some neoplastic etiology, in all these cases we do the surgery. So surgery mostly done nowadays is total or near total thyroidectomy. And before surgery, as we have all studied, we usually give patient potassium iodide, because it reduces the thyroid vascularity, and so that there will be less chances of bleeding after the surgery. Usually we do not defer to do surgery, but only in cases with the gland is very large or if it is presenting with some obstruction. Okay, in that cases only we do. So now let us look into the other thyrotoxicosis causes. So these causes are toxic adenoma and toxic multinodular goiter. So in these cases we have the same kind of management, that is one nodule is over functioning in these cases. Okay, so we have same management, that is firstly we will start with medical management, but the definite management here is radioactive iodine. Okay, so in Graves disease we usually get the remission with the medical phase of management, but in these toxic adenoma and toxic multinodular goiter, radioactive iodine is generally the treatment of choice. Okay, so but if the patient is not responding to both of these, then we will do the surgery. Okay, so surgery profile also provides a definitive treatment, and it also heals the goiter part. Okay, so this is the case. So now let us look into the thyroiditis. Okay, so in thyroiditis the thyrotoxicosis occurs without hyperthyroidism. So as we have seen, in thyroiditis the thyroid gland as such is not overfunctioning, but due to the destruction of the thyroid follicles, the T3 and T4 which are stored in the thyroid follicles, they get released in the blood, and because of that we are having hyperthyroidism clinical features. So because of that, there are three phases in the thyroiditis in which we will see the hyperthyroidism. So these phases you can see in the diagram, that the clinical course of the thyroiditis is usually, first there is thyrotoxic phase because there is destruction by the lymphocyte, and then there is hypothyroidism phase because the thyroid gland as such is not over functioning. Okay, so all the colloid is destroyed and all the hormones are released. So after the release of all the hormones, there is hypothyroid phase, and then there is recovery phase. So both of the thyroiditis, that is subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis and subacute granulomatous thyroiditis, both of these will get resolved on their own in 6 to 9 months. Okay, so silent thyroiditis, it is usually a self-limiting disease and it occurs in middle-aged females and mostly postpartum, that is after pregnancy is over. So in this thyroiditis, we will see lymphocytic infiltrate in the thyroid gland, and these are patchy infiltrates. Okay, and there will be antibody to TPO, thyroid peroxidase, but these antibodies are present only transiently, and this condition resolves by its own in 6 to 9 months. Okay, and ESR will be normal in subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis. So the only management which we require in the subacute lymphocytic thyroiditis is the levothyrox. Okay, in the hypothyroidism phase, so we have seen that the second phase was hypothyroid phase, so we can only management we require here is we may require is levothyrox in the hypothyroidism phase. So in comparison to subacute granulomatous or decorvian thyroiditis, in this there is pain is present in the thyroid gland, and it occurs mainly due to the viral etiology. Okay, it is not due to autoimmune etiology. So thyroid peroxidase antibodies will be absent here, and ESR will be raised because it is due to viral etiology. Okay, so mainly coxsackie, mumps or measles virus is involved, and patient will have pain in the goiter along with fever. So management of this subacute granulomatous thyroiditis, patient we usually require it, we manage it with NSAID and glucocorticoids. Okay, so I have not mentioned both of these in the silent thyroiditis because glucocorticoids are not indicated there in the silent thyroiditis, but here glucocorticoids are indicated, and if patient is having hypothyroidism, then we will also give levothyrox. Okay, so this is how we manage the subacute thyroiditis. Okay, so other cause of thyrotoxicosis, miscellaneous causes, struma aura. Okay, so struma aura is a rare form of monodermal teratoma that mostly contains the thyroid tissue. So if we will do the radioactive iodine uptake scan, so in that we will see there is reduced uptake in the thyroid gland as such, but in the radioactive iodine, if we do whole body scan, then we will see there is ectopic production of the thyroid hormones, that is in the ovaries. Okay, so in struma aura, it is due to teratoma and thyroid gland is not functioning, but T3 and T4 are released by the ovarian teratoma as such. Okay, so this is struma aura. And the last cause is factitious thyroiditis. Factitious thyroiditis means patient is having factitious thyrotoxicosis, means patient is having thyrotoxicosis clinical features because he is overtaking the drugs. Some patient overtake these drugs to reduce their weight or for the insomnia effect. So because of these, patient can have the thyrotoxicosis clinical features. So this is factitious thyrotoxicosis. Okay so now let us wind up this topic by looking into one question, and then we'll take off. Okay, so question is, a patient presented with fever and painful neck swelling, and she gives a history of sore throat and cough 1 week ago. Lab investigation revealed elevated T3 and T4 and elevated ESR. So which one of the following statement about the condition is false? So there is elevated T3 and T4, that is the patient is having thyrotoxicosis. Okay, so and also the patient is having painful neck swelling. So from this we can understand painful neck swelling is in decorvian or subacute granulomatous thyroiditis. Okay, so let us look into the option. Treatment of choice is supportive care and NSAID. Woman is generally affected 3 times more than the man. Both thyrotoxic and hypothyroid phases can be observed. And fourth is, it is autoimmune in origin. So what should be the answer? Okay, so we have already read about the decorvian thyroiditis, that it is due to viral etiology, and treatment of choice is supportive care and NSAID. Okay, along with NSAID, we can give aspirin, steroid and beta blockers to counter the hypothyroidism and hypothyroid phases. Okay, also we can use levothyrox. So female are generally affected more than the male. This is also correct. There are all the phases, thyrotoxic, hypothyroid and resolving phases, but it is not an autoimmune etiology. It is due to viral etiology. Okay, so now we will end up this topic. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like, share and subscribe MedTweak. Okay, thank you.